This meeting of the Owensboro Board of Commissioners to order. Ask our city clerk, please call the row.
Commissioner Bob Glenn.
Bob.
Yes, I'm here.
Commissioner Debbie Nunley.
Here.
Mayor Ron Payne.
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Jeff Sanford.
Here.
Commissioner Pam Smithright.
Here.
All present. I'll ask everyone to please stand as our invocation and pledge is led by our city manager, Mr. Bill Parrish. Bill.
Thank you, Mayor. Would you join me in silent prayer or meditation as may be your practice? Father God, for this agricultural community and for our children who are out of school, we thank you for the perfect balance of sun and rain you have provided for us this season. It just exemplifies your perfect watch care over us as your citizens. And Father God, after just observing Memorial Day and preparing to celebrate Independence Day, our thoughts go to the brave men and women who have sacrificed their lives for our freedom and in defense of democracy. Lord, we pray that you continue to comfort their families. We still mourn those battle losses, Lord God. We mourn the loss of soldiers at Fort Hood and the terrible weather there. We pray, Lord God, your hand of compassion on the family that lost their Blue Angel pilot. And Lord, we thank you for sparing the life of our Thunderbird pilot who was not killed in the crash of his airplane. Lord, we ask you to continue to bless and protect our young men and women serving on foreign battlefields. Comfort their families at home who wait for them. And as always, Lord, we lift up our leaders, the President, the Congress, the Governor and Legislature, this commission, Lord God. Pray that you protect, inspire, and bless their work. It is in Christ's name that I pray, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Now the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Mr. Parrish. Commissioner Pam Smith-Wright, do we have any Vietnam veterans today?
I don't see any,
look like.
Mayor,
okay.
But I do have something I'd like to say.
Carry on.
About that. I've talked with the Department of Defense just this morning, and they are telling me I've had people to ask if they were in the Vietnam era, if they could receive the pins, and they are eligible for the pins. So if Steve, if you could put that in the newspaper, it'd be great. But so we may be having more to come than we've been having because I wasn't sure if they actually had to serve in Vietnam. So they do not. As long as they between, I think he said 55 and 75. Is that right? I think those dates might be
72.
72, okay.
72,
okay.
Well, I tell you, I was pleased at our Memorial Day service that we had as many of the Vietnam vets as we did there. I think both you and I were surprised at how many of them that we had show up. And I know later on that day you had a few more. So, you know, we want to do everything we can to honor all these Vietnam veterans this year. So we will continue to have this on our agenda each meeting for the rest of this year. Commissioners, the next thing I have is a proclamation designating June 5th to 11th as Community Health Improvement Week. I'd like to read this, and I believe Steve Johnson is here. Steve? There he is. To receive this. Proclamation, whereas America's 5,000-plus hospitals and healthcare systems serve a vital role in improving the health of their communities through care provision and community outreach. And whereas improving population health is a key driver of the U.S. healthcare system and community health professionals will play an increasingly important role in healthcare transformation. And whereas Owensboro Health invests $600,000 in health improvement projects each year through the Community Benefit Grant Program. And whereas Community Health Improvement Week recognizes America's community health workforce for their passion and dedication to community health improvement. During this Community Health Improvement Week, we celebrate the legacy of America's hospitals and their community partnerships in working to improve the health of their most vulnerable community members. Now, therefore, I, Ron Payne, Mayor of the City of Owensboro, do hereby proclaim June 5th to 11th, 2016 as Community Health Improvement Week in Owensboro. Owensboro residents are encouraged to celebrate community health initiatives, campaigns, and programs to raise awareness and improve the health of our local communities and show our appreciation for the nation's community health professionals during this week and throughout the year. Signed the 7th day of June, 2016. I will make one comment other than, you know, it being obvious that we want to do everything we can to have a healthy community. But I'll also say this, that has an economic development impact. You know, people looking to move here, create businesses here, they want a healthy community. And, you know, so we want to do everything we possibly can to promote a healthy Owensboro. And I want to commend Owensboro Health for your efforts in working to achieve that goal. It is really, really important, not only for the quality of life for people that live here, but also for the future of this community and our economic development efforts. Steve, if you'd like, I'd like for you to come up and receive this and give you the opportunity to make any comments you would like to make.
Steve Johnson, 400 Forest Lane, Whitesville, Kentucky. I'm going to let Debbie Johnson, who's our Director of Community Engagement, who's really spearheaded these efforts and also the grant program, make a few comments, and then she'll also give you a quick update about what the grant program looks like for this year.
Great,
and again,
Debbie.
Thank you so much,
okay,
Commission.
Steve.
Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. I'm Debbie Zerner-Johnson. I do want to thank you on behalf of Owensboro Health, but also on behalf of the citizens of Owensboro for taking this time to really bring us the opportunity, be able to bring the opportunity to make Community Health Improvement Week something that, and we've never addressed this before as a community, but really setting this time aside to do what you just said, and you really stole exactly what I was going to say, Mayor, because community health is not just about the health department or not just about Owensboro Health or a hospital system. It's really about what each one of us can do, both on an individual basis and the companies we work for, the organizations we work for, the city government or the county government we may be a part of. It's asking ourselves, what can we do to impact priority health needs? What can we do to impact the health of the community? Because as you said, it is not just about the health indicators that we think of, cancer and heart disease and all of the other numerous indicators that we could talk about, but it is about safe sidewalks, safe streets, safe lighting. It's about housing, it's about poverty, it's about education, it's about all of those things that everyone in this room can impact. And we have to ask ourselves the question, what can we do? Because truly, Mayor, it does take all of us to create a healthy community. And when you're moving into a community, if you're a business, if you're a new business, if you're an existing business, you can bet you're looking at those health claims that are costing your money. You're looking at the culture of the community itself to say, I want to move somewhere. I want to be a part of something different. I want to be a part of a community that values health. And so just by setting this week aside, I know a proclamation can be a proclamation, but by setting this aside and really putting some emphasis on community health improvement, then we want to recognize that all citizens have a part to play, both personally and professionally. So I appreciate you allowing us to do that. I also did want to highlight, you know, we use our grant program as a tool. And it's an allocation that that we make on an annual basis to partner with the community. It's not that we allocate those dollars and say good luck, go forth, impact health, and do well. We really partner with the community organizations to be able to look at health issues and all of the ones I mentioned before to impact community health. We just finished receiving our grant applications for this year, and they come to a tune of about $1.6 million. We won't be able to allocate all $1.6 million, but we are dedicated and continue to allocate a large number of grants at the tune of, as you said, about $650,000, $700,000 is what we allocated last year. Over the course of the last few years, it has been several million dollars that we have allocated back to community organizations so they can, by doing what they do best, impact the health of the community. So I share that with you because that's what we're looking at next in this grant cycle is over 62 organizations submitted grants. We're very specific. We're very strategic in that, in those efforts. But it's all in a way that we want to impact the health. We've got to move the needle. We've got to attract businesses, as you said, Mayor, because of the health of this community. And so by doing this, by setting this time aside, and it won't be the first year we do this, we want to continue to do this, it's honoring those. And not just Owensboro Health, but all of those who are striving to improve the health of the community. It is really taking a week aside to say we're honoring those, and then to do some self-reflection to say, what can I do? What can we do as the city commission? What can I do as the mayor? What can we all do to impact the community health, and then go after it? So I appreciate you taking this time aside for us to be able to acknowledge Community Health Improvement Week.
Thank you, Debbie. Commissioners, any comments? Anyone? Commissioner Nunley.
I was just going to piggyback some of Debbie's remarks and just share through some of my reading that the findings are astounding, that I think it's less than 20% of the serious critical illnesses are caused by genetics. The majority of them are caused by the life choices that individuals make and their environment as well. We hear a lot about these healthcare costs and how they're affecting even our city government. And we blame it on Obamacare, but we really should be blaming it on people who make the improper life choices. The people who are suffering from obesity, from diabetes, even cancer, COPD, in many of these cases, it's a matter of life choices. And it's that portion of our population that continues to drive up the cost for not only the people who pay insurance, the private insured, but the taxpayers as well. And it's spiraling out of control. And our community certainly has nothing to brag about when it comes to those statistics. So this is an important proclamation. I'm so glad that the hospital is bringing this to the forefront, and all of those many groups who work so hard and diligently with Debbie to attack this from all different facets of this community.
Good. Anyone?
I just had one very quick question, and that is, I know you do the health survey every year. Where does our diabetes rate in the our service area, Owensboro Health Service Area? Do you have any idea? Our adult diabetes rate, just roughly. But it is pretty high, right?
Need to go.
Sorry.
I have a voice that tends to carry, so
you have a teacher's voice, yeah.
I won't go into history. Our diabetes rates in Davis County are better than our surrounding counties. As you know, Kentucky as a whole is not ranked high in the nation in terms of its health indicators. So diabetes, what we're really looking at around here, as Debbie said, our obesity issues are tremendous. Again, Davis County fares better than its other counties surrounding it. I would encourage you to look at our dashboard on our website. And when I say it's on our dashboard, we happen to host it. It's at www.owensborohealth.org. And just do a search on community dashboard. It is our community, kind of like it or not, but it will tell you the indicators, both our community health indicators and our hospital inpatient and emergency room indicators. It's a great picture of our community, so I would encourage you to look at that. A lot of the issues related to obesity are diabetes, such indicators, and so I'm sorry I can't give you the exact stat, but...
Well, I was just going to say, I know that Vision 2065, yes, with the health committee, I was on it, and there were a lot of good ideas about trying to change the whole culture, not just tell people, no, you can't eat that, or no, you shouldn't do that, but trying to get them to be more active, trying to begin to read labels, for instance. And I know that the FDA has just changed the labels to make them more easier to understand and read, and also make the portions more realistic, because there used to be, half a cookie was a portion, and that, now they're trying to do this to make it more realistic to what we'd normally eat. You don't eat half a potato chip, let's face it. So I commend the hospital and Owensboro Health and all the great work you're doing through your grant program to make us healthier. So
thank you. And it goes beyond choices. Part of it is lifestyle choices, but then you get into policy, you get into ordinances. The work that we have done in this community to address smoking, for example, That directly indicates some significant movement in our community in those health indicators. And so it's not just choices, it is environment and some of the things we build around that, laws, ordinances, policies in schools, policies within our organization. So they all can impact those choices and dramatically so. So I appreciate you drawing that out.
And Debbie, you might want to speak to, the hospital began focusing on particular health issues, three to four health issues, about 4 years ago for our grants program. In terms of recipients who would receive, how do those recipients benefit us with obesity issues and substance and all that? And as I understand, those numbers for Daviess County in comparison to the state have improved over that four-year period in a good fashion. So that does indicate that this focus has helped.
Absolutely. We have, I know it doesn't sound like a lot, but when you reduce numbers of 1% in your childhood and adult obesity rates, you're talking about lives that were greatly impacted. So yes, we have seen some great improvement. And numbers of youth smoking have gone down, adult smoking has gone down. There's been some real strategic work on that, and we're mandated to conduct that community health needs assessment every 3 years, and we do so in partnership with the Green River District Health Department, so it's not like you have a lot of documents floating around out there. There's one document that guides this, and when we want to allocate those funds, organizations in this community must look at the community health needs assessment, and they must choose one of the priority health issues in order to be considered for funding. So it's not funding just to be funding because people are, you've got good organizations. We're talking about organizations that are focused on that health needs assessment and going after those indicators.
Very good. Anyone else?
If not, all my questions. You did great.
Yeah, very good. Steve, Debbie, thank y'all very much for coming. Commissioners, we'll now go to an update in regards to the Owensboro-Daviess County Regional Airport. Mr. Bob Whitmer will make this presentation. Bob, welcome back home.
It's a pleasure returning to this room and seeing all the familiar faces with elected officials and the staffs. Thank you for inviting me on behalf of the Owensboro-Daviess County Regional Airport Board. The first slide, I think we should be recognizing who makes up that board. We have a great deal of expertise, legal, financial, professional, managerial experience on this board. And you probably know very well, because you all have appointed 5 of the 10 board members that govern and direct your airport. The other 5 are appointed by Daviess County Fiscal Court. Now, the first thing I want to do before we really get into the presentation is highlight some of the features at the airport that the viewing public may be most interested in. So it's just a 1-minute video, Bill, so it won't be too long. I remember him well. I just hope to provide the viewing community, the people that are watching this on TV that may not realize what kind of aircraft you have flying in and out of your airport. The context of this presentation will be a SWOT analysis, and you know that's a common managerial term. You know, that represents the strengths of the airport, some of the weaknesses, some of the opportunities that we're about to face and some of the threats we should be on the lookout for involving your airport. Now, and also during this presentation, want to talk about the role that the City Commission plays in promoting and supporting the airport. I want to remind you all that and inform the viewing public what you do for the airport. First of all, we have a lot of strengths. Probably number one, honestly, is the control tower. We're very, very fortunate to have a control tower. Out of 53 airports in Kentucky, only five are controlled by towers. We have air controllers at the airport from 6 in the morning till 10 at night, 365 days a year. The only other airports that have it are Greater Cincinnati, Louisville International, Lexington, Paducah, and us. This is a real asset. Secondly, we have an 8,000-foot runway. Only Greater Cincinnati and Louisville International have runways as long as we do. Lexington, 7,200. We can land almost any aircraft manufactured in the world at our airport. We also, and to complement that 8,000-foot runway, we have an east-west 5,000-foot secondary runway. And that's a pretty good map to look at for a second, because you can see the location of the airport. We're right off the bypass. We're just right on the outskirts of the city. And if you look to the west, the bottom of the photo you're looking at, we have a lot of available land. And I think that's a good overview of your airport. Air service, we fly in and fly out over 44,000 passengers per year. We're very fortunate to have two airlines at our airport. And a quotation, a saying that's kind of famous among airports is, 1 mile of roadway will take you a mile. 1 mile of runway will take you anywhere in the world. And that's true. When you've got air service, we're the envy of a lot of smaller communities in having an airline such as Allegiant in Owensboro. Most small communities, even larger communities than us, are vying for that service. And we top that off with the largest commuter airline in the country with Cape Air. Of course, we have an Orlando destination. It's the most popular vacation destination in the United States. You can get there in an hour and a half nonstop from your airport. What really satisfies the business community much more, though, than the leisure traveler is that you can get to St. Louis three times a day, early morning, midday, and late day, and connect to 70 national and international destinations at a large hub. And this is 365 days a year. Not only that flight going out, remember that flight's coming in. It's bringing the customers into Owensboro. It's getting people to their headquarters. It's bringing the suppliers in town. The airport's created a lot of jobs over the last few years with the airlines, with TSA, with the fixed-based operators. The businesses on the airport have added personnel. Mid-America Jet is our largest fixed-based operator. They had a kind of a lull back in 2008, 2009 when the economy was down, but they've come back very strong. Mid-America Jet offers fueling, charter service. Not only here, they've expanded into Nashville. And Mid-America Jet is a maintenance center for Cirrus. Cirrus is a type of aircraft. This is a real strong designation. And they've grown tremendously and hired personnel at their facility. General Aviation, we have 56 aircraft hangared at OWB. And I just left the funeral about an hour and a half ago for Robert Dizell, one of our pilots. And half the room appeared to be his colleagues at the airport. We have a very strong aviation community led by the Air Flying Club. They're a very close-knit group. And one thing I've recognized about pilots is they're adventurous people, and a lot of them are entrepreneurs by nature. You know, they're the type that get out and try and experiment, and you'll see that at airports. XL Aviation in the last year and a half has started flight instruction. They've grown steadily over this last year and a half. We hadn't had flight instruction at the airport for 10 years. Community events, you've led the way. You've brought an air show to this community, and we've benefited. You know, we have the display, the static display out there on Friday night. You know, we're the base for the flights on Saturday and Sunday. You guys spearhead that, and we benefit, and we thank you for that. Community events, we've been able to partner with the Convention Center in the Visitors Bureau to attract the Kentucky Aviation Conference in 2015, and they decided to return this year. And one reason they decided to return was they wanted to schedule their event 3 days before the air show, so they could have their conference at the Convention Center, and then people could stay around that have a passion for aviation and watch the air show. We are starting a new day in coordination with the Visitors Bureau. We're trying to create a new awareness of the airport. We're going to have a open house from 4:30 to 8:30 on July 9th. We're trying to create awareness to so many of those people in the community that really still don't realize you can fly out of Owensboro the way you can. It surprises me how many times I hear that, and I hear people say that they hear from other people. I want to get into a little more depth about Allegiant, the benefits to the community. I mean, the great thing is that it provides a service. You know, for many years there was no air service here, and you can get to Florida. You know, a lot of family and friends have connections in Florida, and they travel back and forth. It's not just vacation people. But what I don't think a lot of people understand is what it does for us financially. You know, we have a $786,000 operational budget, and the revenues of Allegiant outpace the expenditures by about $75,000. So they help our operating budget, but more importantly, on the capital side, this does not fall back on the local community, and we would not have 10,000 employments. Employments are defined as paid boardings that are departing from your airport. When you surpass $10,000, the FAA awards you $1 million per year. Well, we've gotten $7 million, and we've done a lot of good projects because of Allegiant. In fact, you know, you had a very inadequate terminal, and we were trying to accommodate 155 passengers in this area where you would pick up your luggage. See in the top right there, that was our baggage carousel. Trying to get 140 pieces of luggage on that didn't work very well. This is your terminal today. We've quadrupled the baggage carousel. We have 80 airport seats in the lobby, 180 in the holding area. We've opened it up. It's much more colorful. We highlight something else that you had a great deal to do with, and that's the riverfront. We're as proud of it as you are. And we showcase it, and the people that come in and out of the airport have very favorable comments about that. The holding area was very subpar. We tried to put 155 people in a room like this that probably shouldn't have had more than 50 in it. When we were able to take some of that money awarded to us because of Allegiant, we were able to expand it. The chairs in there, Bill may remember, Mr. Parrish may remember very well, they came out of the timeout lounge. I think we paid y'all $1.50 a piece for those.
Now, Bobby, why would Bill remember that? go ahead.
Now, here is our holding area. We quadrupled the size. And holding area, by the way, if I should define that, is the post-TSA screening, you know, what's called the sterile area by TSA. This is where you wait before you board the aircraft. We didn't even have restrooms back there. And so now we've got a very attractive area. This is the exterior prior to the renovation. This is now. So you're able to sit in that room. It's an all-glass enclosure. You can see the planes arrive and depart. Not only have we helped the areas for the public, but now the operational areas are much improved. You know, we can store our equipment under canopies. We used to work out in the rain and the snow with people's luggage, and you can imagine what that was. That's no longer the case. That aircraft rescue and firefighting truck, Chief Miller here, that's probably twice the size of most of your firefighting equipment. It's required by the FAA, and because we have Allegiant, we have to have a certain index firefighting capability, and we got that what would today be $1 million truck, 100% paid for by the FAA. And again, we would not have that if we did not have over 10,000 employments out of our airport. We've been able to purchase snow equipment because we qualified. We became eligible for the FAA funds, again, because of the numbers that Allegiant has produced. We just ordered a new snowplow. And while I'm on that subject, that's something else the city has helped us do. I've contacted Bill Parrish or the Public Works Department, Wayne Shelton, and in a couple of crisis situations where we had large aircraft coming into the airport, they come out and help us clean our runways. And I'd like to thank you all for allowing them to do that, because I know what you deal with 280 miles of streets, and I'm calling you. So thank you for that. We were also able to get $1 million from the FAA to do some additional paving. That's a bird's eye view of the terminal. To the left there, you see the apron. The light colored concrete is all new. I wasn't able to show you the new taxiway that we built, but all that was to satisfy the requirements for large commercial aircraft. And again, most of that $1.7 million there was paid 100% by the federal government. Now, what are some of our weaknesses? Well, you know those too. We have an operating budget, as I mentioned, of $786,000. You help us with 12% of that funding. Our revenues are 76%. The county pays 12%, and you do, to subsidize your airport. One of my objectives coming from this building is I wanted to be able to be self-sustaining, and I know our board feels the same way. Have not gotten there yet. On a much lesser scale, you have to have a local match for this $1 million grant that we get each year. What that boils down to is the city has to pay $28,000, the county has to pay $28,000, but we leverage $1 million for that commitment. But again, we strive to get to the point where we can handle that. That's what we hope to do at some point. OWE does not offer fuel services. I won't get into this, but this would be something we would really like to be able to do at some point, build our own fuel farm. We think we'd be much more attractive in recruiting additional commercial service. Succession planning, we only have 4 full-time employees at the airport. We have very limited staff. You know, we are Allegiant Airlines. They have no employees. Now, we do have part-time employees, but that's our full-time staff. We just lost one of our maintenance workers who retired, and the other 3 will probably be rotating out in the next couple years. So we're going to do some strategic planning at the airport and figure out what is going to be our plan for succession. Some of the key opportunities, we have 166 acres of developable land at the airport. You see the parcels there and how much acres each of those take. You know, we just had an announcement a couple of months ago that a large flight school, APAS Air, is moving from California to our airport. And when they made the announcement, the first thing the CEO said was, we wanted a controlled tire airport. We want an air-controlled airport, and that's one thing that came. We also have very clear airspace, and you know, our infrastructure is excellent. We have a brand new $2.3 million instrument landing system, and they wanted their pilots to train under those conditions. But Joe, we're already home to several corporate businesses: Franklin Investments, Independence Bank, the Malcolm Bryan Association, Sterrett. Crane and Rigging has moved out to the airport in the last 2 years. Pallet Steel has been there for about 10 years. Of course, Gulfstream, who owns Mid-America Jet, Matt Hayden, they operate out of our airport. Modern Welding has about 8 locations across the United States. This is their home base. And we've got several other smaller businesses. Economic development. Now, you know, we don't drive this economy by ourselves. I think we certainly understand it. But we do think we're kind of a spoke in the wheel. You know, we want the intermodal transportation. You all have worked very hard to improve the roads. You know, the I-65 spur, the I-69 spur, and you've done that. You know, we've got a great river port with, right on the Ohio River, water service, and we think we play a role in that too with excellent infrastructure and air service. So we have all the 3 modes of transportation in Owensboro that can assist and help the Madison Silvertson and you guys in luring a new business to this community. You know, Madison Silvert will tell you one of the first questions he's ever asked is, do you have air service? Initiatives to grow aviation and general aviation in this region. And I think this has got an economic development side to it also. Because once you start developing these pallets, you know, the Trey Sterrett of Sterrett Transportation is a pallet. Ray Asmire, Pallet Steel, he names it after his occupation. So a lot of these people may, you know, produce other benefits in the future. So what we've done is we've worked very hard to build that groundswell of aviation interest. And one of the key programs is a 2+2 program that's spearheaded by the Owensboro Community and Technical College, Eastern Kentucky University, and Mid-America Jet. You can get a 4-year aviation degree, whether that be in mechanics, a pilot degree, or aeronautical engineering. You can get that in Owensboro now without ever leaving your city. And that's just started. Another one is the Owensboro Public Schools has started a 4-year program. You go in as a freshman and take aviation classes, continue sophomore, junior, and senior year, and you're well equipped at that point to move forward with a 4-year degree. Excel has started a youth program to build interest among teenagers, and you see one of their meetings here of a few months ago where I took a photograph. That's taking off real well also. All these things are going to take a while to materialize and really, you know, probably serve a benefit. But we do have an older population among our general aviation pilot group at the airport. And we need to be doing something to grow an influx of new pilots. Another partnership is Kentucky Wesleyan College and APUS Air, APUS Air being the flight training school I mentioned to you a moment ago. What these candidates are going to come in here is with 1 year to 2 years of college. And KWC is partnering with them to not only house them on campus, but to get them a bachelor's degree. Apparently, that's a big deal when they go back to some of these countries, is having a bachelor's degree from the United States. And I think you're going to hear a lot more about this. This is something that I don't think has been talked about a lot that I think is a big deal. Of course, again, the city had a great deal to do with bringing the National Guard Armory to our airport. It is on airport property, and you all were very influential in making that happen. So we have excellent emergency response facilities at the airport. We're getting ready to build a new aircraft rescue and firefighting facility. We're right now in the process of hiring the architects to do that. We've got the FAA funding that will cover the largest portion of that facility. But what has been determined is the military came in here and did an evaluation of all the airports in Western Kentucky. And if you were to have an earthquake of the magnitude of the one of 1811, which has been estimated to be like 7.8, 8.2 on the Richter scale, what would survive? How would you get supplies, personnel, and equipment into Western Kentucky? It's a St. Madrid fault, right, that is the risk. Well, most roads would be impassable, bridges would be impassable, so how do you get these supplies into your communities? It's by air. So they did a very in-depth study of all the airports to determine which ones would survive with an earthquake the magnitude of what I just mentioned. And the only one in Western Kentucky would be the Owensboro-Daviess County Regional Airport. You know, you all helped make that $26 million, 8,000-foot runway happen. Well, not only was the length improved, it was reinforced. So it is anticipated, along with the accompanying taxiways, to survive a disaster of that scale. So therefore, your community is going to be where the equipment, the supplies, and the personnel flow into Western Kentucky. There's got to be a benefit to the proximity. So I think this is something that's been talked about very little. What are some of the threats? I'm not going to get into a lot of detail, but you know what they are, and you've been influential here also. Is we've had concerns of losing our control tower. We really don't have the flight activity at the airport to justify it. So what have we done in the last couple of years? We've lobbied to keep this while we build the number of flight activities, while we get more flight instruction in here, while we get more APUS Air, while we build our general aviation population, while we build our commercial service to have more flight activities. Well, I've never asked you all or physical court or the state officials to help us that you haven't done it. We've done it unanimously and effectively in contacting our federal elected officials. So we've been able to maintain it. You know, it was a date was given to close our control tower down in 2013, but it didn't happen. But the things that are going on at the airport, we are building our numbers, and APUS Air could actually increase that number many-fold. So that's an ongoing challenge. Cape Air, you heard us talk last year about the concern of losing the Essential Air Services program. That is a federally subsidized program. You helped us again. You allowed the airport to locate some signs promoting their service on some very conspicuous, visible properties. You got criticized, and I got criticized for that. But it was short term. And I think that, you know, the benefits of that have definitely outweighed, you know, some of the concerns that were voiced. We're up 35% in our Cape Air employment. So we now think we're meeting the thresholds to keep this program for another 4 years. And again, remember, that's our connection. That's our economic development tool.
Bobby, that 35%, is that over last year?
That's over about the last 12 months.
Okay.
The, you know, it's all based on the federal fiscal year, which is October 1 to September 30. But we're pretty comfortable that we're going to reach this. And, you know, I see it every day, so I see a lot more people flying Cape Air. The last threat I'm going to mention is everybody in this room very well that Allegiant's now flying out of Evansville to the same destination we fly. You know, we've gone from actually two flights a week, two departures, two arrivals, to six departures in this area and six arrivals. You know, Allegiant thinks this is a opportunity, you know, region to grow with another location more convenient for Southern Indiana and the potential for us to grow here. And we will lose customers out of Evansville. You know, they are going to stagger the days of the departures, and that's a good thing. But we will lose some customers. We get quite a few passengers from Evansville. So what we have decided we must do at the airport, and again, you've helped us in talking to the Visitors Bureau and getting them on board. I've got a great team of marketers there. They're working with Cape Air. They're working with Allegiant. And we're going to try to capture a new customer base that may be unaware of this service in Western Kentucky. If we can grow Bowling Green, if we can grow Madisonville, Paducah, Hopkinsville, Litchfield, some of the Indiana towns are closer to Owensboro than they are Evansville, Jasper, Tell City. So we're going to work on a marketing blitz over the next few months to try to replace that customer base that we know we're going to lose to some degree. And again, remember, if we do lose Allegiant, we lose that $1 million in federal aviation funding. And I don't want to be the one that comes down here and ask you to repair or provide an overlay for a 5,000-foot runway. You know, that Wayne Shelton can tell you what that would cost. So we do recognize what you and the county do for the airport. The first thing you see when you walk in the airport is this on the wall. If you enjoy flying from your hometown, thank your Owensboro City Commission and Davis County Fiscal Court. We recognize what you do, and we want to thank you here tonight as we provide you this update. And working with the city and the other agencies, we think all the progress in Owensboro is going to continue. And for the airport and the community, we think we're going to steal a little pun here. The sky's the limit. Any questions? Anything I can do?
Bobby, a couple things. One is I periodically, you know, every once in a while I get out on that golf course, and I see these huge planes flying around. They look like military cargo planes. Is that a function of the National Guard out there?
It's not. You know, we don't actually have an apron yet. That's phase two of the National Guard. However, you know, Mid-America Jet has picked up some military fueling contracts. We get a lot of Blackhawks into the airport. You see that C-130 flying all the time. You know, I get calls every now and about being too low. But we're getting more military training to our base than over the past several years.
You know, I would hope somehow we continue to pursue that. You know, at one time, I think it was a remote possibility of us getting an air wing, National Guard air wing in here or whatever, but with that huge runway, and I hope that we continue to work on that. One of the things you didn't mention, and I travel every once in a while out of that airport and use Cape Air, and I got to tell you, that is just a wonderful opportunity we have here. And I hope more and more people take advantage of it. But it's my understanding, once you get into or pass the security there, in Owensboro Airport and you get into that system and you go to St. Louis or New York or whatever, you're already in the system by having virtue of the fact you went through it here. Is that correct?
That's true. Cape Air has had an interlining agreement with all the legacy carriers, and the legacy carriers are American, Delta, United. Now, Southwest does not, so they don't interline with anybody. You know, you, if you deal with Southwest, you have to grab your bag at whatever airport you connect. But any of the other airlines, you're absolutely correct. When you check that bag here and you end up in Seattle, you don't have to mess with it. You don't have to leave security and go through TSA screening. Everybody's seen on TV.
That's what I was going
to. That's come to.
I think you need to plug that. I've got to tell you that I've done that many times and a couple times overseas. And that is a wonderful benefit we have here, to be able to go through that security and get into that system and not have to fool with it when you get to Atlanta or New York or whatever. And I got to tell you that we really ought to tout that, because, you know, having watched some of the news coverage on TV, my gosh, that's just frightening to think you have to have stand in those lines that long. And you get kind of spoiled, you know, utilizing Cape Air here and getting into that system. So I think that's a wonderful, wonderful benefit. Before I open it up to questions from the other commissioners, I want to tell you how impressed I am and pleased with the job you're doing. Bobby, I got to tell you, sir, you have done one heck of a job out there with that airport. And to tell us here this evening that you only have four full-time employees, I think that's phenomenal that you're doing all of this with just four full-time employees. And it really, really is impressive. And on the part of this, behalf of this commission of the people of Owensboro, I got to tell you, thank you so much for all you're doing. And I know you got a great board, and I'm sure they agree with me in regards to this. But I know a couple of them are here, Jerry Yizer and Brenda Clayton. You guys out there are doing a wonderful, wonderful job. You really are. And we got a tremendous asset out there with that airport and that 8,000-foot runway. And I know y'all are doing everything you can to fully utilize and take advantage of that asset. And Bob, you're just to be commended.
Thank you.
Commissioners, I'll start over here. Commissioner Glenn.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Just two quick questions, and I want to echo the mayor. There's no doubt your board and your staff are doing an outstanding job, and you as well, Bob. So, again, kudos. The first is APUS. You had one slide. So what's our time frame on APUS coming in, and where will they kind of set up operations?
Okay, they're looking at a couple of different sites on the airport. They haven't identified. They're going to have to do some geotechnical work and you know, look at the expenses on the two options. They, by the agreement that's been written, they have to start construction by October 1, so they'll do their design phase and begin construction by October 1, to be done with construction by July 15th, and to bring their first class in August, which has to be a minimum of 30 students. And 30 students flying several hours a day will generate a great deal of flight activities, and that's what we want.
Well, and there's the follow-up question. So who's going to handle, are you going to need staff, part-time staff, to handle takeoffs and landings? Or are they just the instructor and
no,
the
sir.
Student?
You know, the control tower is funded by the FAA. It's a third-party administrator, Midwest Air Control, that actually handles that. But that's funded. You know, at one point, we thought we might have to take that over. Well, their budget is as big as ours. Well, that's a stretch. Theirs is about $530,000. You know, ours is like 768. So, you know, we certainly wanted to maintain, create that need, and retain what we've got rather than try to take it over ourselves. We will not, in answer to your question, you know, we don't see hiring any additional staff to deal with a new flight instruction company.
Okay, and then the other question tying it to the TSA issue. There's pre-TSA, I guess you can go in and apply. Is that available for those flying out of Owensboro, or would that be a wasted investment?
That would be a wasted investment. You know, our lines are so short. You can go to Evansville and acquire that. There's an expense to it. There's a cost to it. I would not advise that, you know, coming through our airport. Now, you may want to, you know, if you're going to go somewhere else, very
it might
well
help made. If I'm flying Southwest out of St. Louis, right?
Yeah, St. Okay. Louis's lines, I've questioned them quite a bit about, you know, their TSA weight, and they've been able to control it pretty well. You know, I think it's Chicago and Atlanta and some of the really big ones that have generated these 2 and 3 hour rates, weights, but not so much St. Louis.
So we just saved everybody, I think it's $85 and a lot of giving away for your life.
I haven't gone and gotten it, I can tell you that. Yeah.
So. Thank you, Bob. Appreciate it.
Well, I have my pre-TSA, and I think Owensboro is better than having a pre-TSA.
Good.
I wanted to ask you a couple things, or say something and ask you a question. I was at the APIS press conference, and how many employees were they going to bring in?
They're talking about 30 to 35.
I thought it was 25, so 30 to 35 employees
yes,
that they're
ma'am.
Bringing in. Okay. And then just also, I just think, Bobby, it is unbelievable what you and your board have done over there in such a short amount of time. You have transformed that airport. Brenda, I know you've been around for a long time. Jerry, and you guys, we're just so thankful. Having been in the relocation business with real estate, bringing people in for over 35 years, airport was one of the number one questions.
Oh, really? That's mm-hmm. good to hear.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, because a lot of these people are corporate people, and it's important for them to be able to navigate. So,
well, I can't help but recognize both our board members, and these are both city appointees, by the way. Brenda's been on our board for 18 years.
Yeah.
And she's been through the best of times and the worst of times, and I can promise you she's a leader and a visionary. So, yeah, I appreciate your kind remarks, but... You know, we've had some pretty good people setting the vision and direction for that.
Well, just
airport.
Innovative. I mean, very innovative in how you're getting all of these major expenses paid for through other entities.
You know, and I have to compliment the Economic Development Corporation. We're working on two projects right now, one with the state and another that I happen to fall into, and hopefully there'll be, you know, some other. I know that's what, you know, jobs are pretty much the answer to most all your problems. It's a panacea, and I understand, you know, that's something that's, you know, our mission is to promote general aviation, to get commercial service, and to assist in economic development, and that's something that I don't think, you know, in my years out there we've been as successful as I certainly would have liked to be. Now, we've had a couple of things develop here lately, and maybe it's the economy getting better. You know, I went out there in 2009 when it was kind of at its ebb, and I'm seeing more things happen. I'm glad to see Mid-America Jet flourishing. They're doing well, and they're a big part of the airport. Anything that happens out there, you got to have the support services. We don't provide the fuel. We don't provide the maintenance. We don't do the charter service. Primarily, Mid-America Jet does that.
Any other? Commissioner, anything?
No, I'm good.
Mayor Pro Tem?
Yes. Commissioner Nunley actually asked my question. So thanks. I was going to ask about how many jobs from APIS Air. Well, how many students are they expecting?
Well, I think they're starting out with 30. But, you know, I've heard numbers, you know, 60 to 80. And, you know, housing 60 to 80. You know, and you can imagine what a boost this could be for KWC.
Yeah.
Because it's a real interesting business plan. I guess I'm not conveying anything that's not universally known in the flight instruction world, but these airlines prepay to bring these students in. And so they pay up front, a pretty good sum of money up front. And I happen to ask, because, you know, most of these are going to be Asian, whether they're Korean, Japanese, Chinese, they're moving into India, they're moving into Brazil. And I asked about the Chinese pilots. I said, well, what if you spend that large sum of money, and it's a large sum, to pay in advance to come over and do this? I said, what if they decide they don't like it, or they, you know, they just they want to quit? And they looked at each other and they said, that never happens. Said, you would shame your family and you would shame yourself, and that doesn't happen, which I thought was very interesting and, you know, very
just one complimentary. Last comment.
Go ahead.
You hit the nail on the head about jobs and economic development. I think our airport is second to none, and I've flown out of there many times, and
the Riverport also, together with those two entities, you guys, we're here for you tonight, and you've done an excellent job. I'll echo with the mayor and everyone else up here. But that's what it comes down to is, you know, you guys are doing great things, and I'm sure there's things I don't know about that you're working on, and that jobs are very important, and I think we're going to get more of them. And I appreciate all the hard work that you've done, you and the board members. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you all.
Bobby, thank you.
Commissioners, we'll now go to our business items. First is to consider approval of the minutes of our meeting dated May 17, 2016. I'll entertain a motion for approval.
Motion. Second.
Any questions, comments by anyone? Call for the vote.
Commissioner Glenn?
Yes.
Commissioner Nunley?
Yes.
Mayor Payne?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Sanford?
Yes.
Commissioner Smithright?
Aye.
Motion passes. Commissioners, we have no ordinances for second reading. We'll go to the one, we have one for first reading. Counselor?
Thank you, Mayor. Commissioners, Ordinance 15-2016, an ordinance amending the annual budget for the fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2015 and ending June 30th, 2016, and amending Ordinance 10-2015 to receive Homeland Security grant funds for purchase of 10 portable radios to reflect revenues and expenditures from the Run from the Cops event, to provide funding in the State Drug Fund for unforeseen repairs and canine dental work, to fund the budget contingency, to provide for funding in the Property Recovery Fund for renovations in the Police Department Records Unit, to provide for receipt of and reimbursement of occupational license fees in relation to Kentucky business incentives, to provide for temporary funding in transit from general fund until federal funds are received, and to reclassify a portion of the International Bluegrass Music Center construction funds to agency funds. Introduced and publicly read on first reading this 7th day of June, 2016.
This is first reading. We will not vote on this, but Mr. Parrish, you mind walking us through these?
Certainly, Mayor. There are 10 elements to this budget amendment. They're located behind the ordinance's first reading tab. 16-36 relates to a Homeland Security grant. Your authority to accept a $23,000 grant, no match required, to purchase 10 portable handheld radios that will be maintained in our mobile command post that would be used by other agencies that come to Owensboro in time of emergency or crisis to ensure radio compatibility, no cost to the city. 16-37 relates to the Juvenile Drug Diversion Fund, the purpose of which is to support camp cops targeted at underprivileged and at-risk youth. Revenues generated from various events and registration fees, from DARE golf scrambles to Run from the Cops. This budget amendment is your authorization to accept an additional $7,500 in revenue from the Run from the Cops registrations and sponsorships, and to allow spending in the amount of $5,000 on the Run for the Cops race, t-shirts, race supplies, etc., a net gain of $2,500 to support camp cops at no cost to the taxpayer. 16-38 relates to the State Drug Fund. Revenues are generated by OPD participation in state anti-drug operations, resulting in asset seizures and funds for OPD. Expenditures are authorized in support of the police department's operations. This budget amendment is your authorization to spend $2,500 on dental work for one of our canine officers, vehicle maintenance on asset forfeiture vehicles, and OPD training. As revenues were generated by seized criminal assets, no cost to the taxpayer. 16-39 relates to the general fund of the city, supporting most of our departments. Because we know that we will not spend all authorized dollars that were originally budgeted, we budgeted to recoup in the 15-16 budget $750,000 of authorized budget expenditures. We are recouping that in four areas. The retirement contingency was not all used. Pension spiking funds were not all used. Transfer to debt service. The Bluegrass Museum borrowing was 1 year later than planned, so we saved that debt service. And efficiencies in OPD. This budget amendment recoups $750,000 to fund the contingency. 16-40 relates to the Property Recovery Fund, where revenues are received by found property or unclaimed evidence property being sold at auction. This budget amendment is your authorization to spend $7,000 on records retention room modifications, allowing placement of the front desk officer behind a bulletproof glass screen, no cost to the taxpayer. 16-41 relates to the Economic Development Fund, which is funded by airpark properties taxes, revenues being dedicated here. The fund is used to provide development and employment incentives. There are two here in cooperation with KBI state incentives that are maturing. The change is necessitated by growth in the Sazerac's jobs, reimbursing 1% of the occupational tax. That is now up to 208 additional jobs in our community. We still receive the 0.06 to the general fund and 0.33 to your community vision. We're reimbursing $23,785 there. There's also growth in First Security jobs. They are now up to 33 additional jobs, reimbursing $9,789. The Transit Fund, Budget Amendment 16-42, relates to the Transit Fund for our Public Transportation Department. That is funded by riders' fees, federal, state, and city governments. Now, federal and state governments have reduced their funding by a combined $291,209 out of the capital account. This budget amendment transfers $100,000 from the city's general fund to reduce that impact down to $191,000. This budget amendment also recognized $191,000 in belt tightening by Wayne Shelton, the Public Works Department, in transit. We've requested to transfer $100,000 from the federal government in our operating expenses to the capital expenses, but that's not authorized yet because the federal government enacted a new computer system for the transit departments a year ago. The system still does not work, and they can't transfer any funds. So we have to temporarily advance $100,000. We hope next year to be able to get that money transferred and reimburse the general fund. 16-43 relates to Capital Projects Fund, providing financing for such. This is your authorization to transfer $615,000 to the IBMC related to building construction from the $4.4 million raised by Bluegrass for this project. That'll cover pre-opening expenses such as building insurance, FF&E, moving expenses, 3 months of operating expenses, an entertainment risk pool, and moving out of the River Park Center. They have to do some required work at the center to meet the requirements of their lease.
Bill, let me ask you right there. Sir. That $4.4 million, did it go into this fund?
That's correct, Mayor. Is that right? Yeah.
Okay, that's all. I understand. Thank you.
16-44 receives that $615,000 that was transferred in the budget amendment I just spoke about. 16-45, the last one, is related to the debt service fund where we pay our debts and loans from. This budget amendment authorizes transfer of $646,475 from your community vision, where we save funds for projects like this, to debt service to pay for KIA debt services for $22.9 million in debt we incurred for stormwater projects that are solving flooding problems within the city. Mayor, that concludes the totality of the budget amendment.
Very good. Thank you so much. Yeah, questions of Mr. Parrish? Anyone? Yes, ma'am.
The radios, the 10 radios. Do we get those every year? I'm not imagining that.
No, we occasionally get radios, but this is a specific one that allows ART to hold radios in our command center. So if, for example, we have a crisis and officers from Louisville or Evansville come to support us, their radios may not work here. We can give them those radios, and they can talk to our police department 911 center.
Okay, and
that was a problem during the 2000 tornado. We had a lot of people came in here to help us with that, and we had a real problem with communications. So hopefully we won't have that in the future.
And the other question is, this dog having a root canal?
I would have to defer to Dr. Elam, but I know it is it's a tooth work on this, and it's not a dog; it's an officer.
I think it's a canine.
Yeah, but my point is, it's a police officer.
Oh, okay. Well, oh, right. Okay.
Have a little respect.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Anything else? Anyone?
I've got
yes,
one
sir.
Quick
go
question.
Ahead.
Item 16-40, Mr. Parrish.
Sure.
So just for the public's benefit, the $7,000 is going to be used to kind of remodel The officer on duty, when you walk into the station, will now be will have an enclosed, protected area.
That's
still he or she will still deal with the public,
right.
But citizens will see a difference. They won't just be sitting there out in the open.
That's correct. The mood in the city of Owensboro, we have great relations. We have a very respectful, polite community. But the mood nationally has changed, and we're concerned that that police officer out front by himself, meeting with the public, that he be protected.
That sounds perfectly reasonable. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Anyone else? Anyone from the public? Next item, Counselor.
Municipal Order 18-2016, a municipal order authorizing the mayor to negotiate and execute a memorandum of understanding by and between the City of Owensboro and Marathon Pipeline, LLC, the terms of which outline the use of Marathon Pipeline's fire equipment, introduced and publicly read for approval this 7th day of June, 2016.
Do we have a motion for approval?
Motion.
Second.
Mr. Parrish, you want to explain this, or we got fire chief?
I can give you a very quick explanation.
Go ahead.
This municipal order is acceptance of a very gracious offer from Marathon Pipeline for our fire department to borrow Marathon's firefighting equipment if we have a need. That consists of a trailer with over 1,000 feet of hose. They can pull that up to the Ohio River, drop it in the river, send it out to one of our pumpers and feed water in time of crisis or emergency, or out of a swimming pool or a lake or anywhere else. And they have a 6,000 gallon per minute pumper on a trailer hooked to a pickup truck that we can borrow if the need arises. It's a very gracious offer, requires nothing from the city. Very good corporate citizens.
Great. Yeah, we appreciate that. Okay. Any questions? But go ahead, Commissioner.
I did have one question. So if their equipment is damaged, chief to answer this? Chief? I was reading this over, and there were just two very quick questions, and that is, so this is only on an as-needed basis. We don't take permanent control of their equipment, right?
That'd be correct. We train with them monthly on their equipment.
Okay.
And we assist them in maintaining it. Which is there's no cost to us to do that.
Okay.
And in return we get the use of it if it's needed,
but only if we need it. Beyond the training, we have to contact them and get a hold of
Correct.
It if we need it in an emergency. Okay. And then the second question is, it noted that if any there was any damage, which makes sense, obviously we would be responsible. So how do we handle this? Is it just on the city insurance, or do we take out a special policy to handle this as a rider?
Yeah.
How does that get covered?
It is on the city's insurance.
Okay, so we would just repair it on our. Okay, yeah, it sounds like a great deal, but I just wondered about those two factors. Okay, wonderful. Thank you, Chief.
It's no different than any mutual aid agreement,
yeah,
that we have with anybody else.
Yeah, sounds great.
Any other questions? Anyone from the public? Call for the vote.
Commissioner Nunley?
Yes.
Mayor Payne?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Sanford?
Yes.
Commissioner Smithwright?
Aye.
Commissioner Glenn?
Yes. Motion passes. Thank you. We have no more business items, commissioners, except the city manager's items. Mr. Parrish.
Thank you, Mayor. I'm asking the commission tonight to consider the following personnel appointments. Sarah Harris, probationary full-time, non-civil service appointment, accounting clerk, effective June 13th. Michael Nichols, probationary full-time, non-civil service promotional appointment, police sergeant, effective June 13th. Clinton Jones, regular, full-time, non-civil service appointment, driver, effective June 8th. Jason Bishop, regular, full-time, non-civil service appointment, maintenance worker, effective June 15th. And Larry Friels, regular, full-time, non-civil service appointment, fire lieutenant, effective June 15th.
Do we have a motion for approval?
Motion.
Second.
Any questions, comments? Call for the vote.
Mayor Payne?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Sanford?
Yes.
Commissioner Smithwright?
Aye.
Commissioner Glenn?
Yes.
Commissioner Nunley?
Yes.
Motion passes. Anything further, Mr. Parrish?
Just one final comment, Mayor. Just recognizing that Owensboro for the 9th consecutive year is the host site for the Kentucky High School Athletic Association Girls State Fast Pitch Tournament. That's 16 finest teams in the state come here to compete for the championship. The games are at Fisher Park Softball Complex beginning Thursday at 5 p.m., running through Saturday. The championship game is Saturday at 1 o'clock. Congratulations to Davis County High School, which is in the tournament, one of those 16 teams. And also congratulations to our Parks and Recreation Department, who's been able to secure this project, which is really for us an economic development project, to keep money flowing in our community. So good job by them.
Great.
Very good. We will now go to communications from elected officials. I'll start, Commissioner Glenn.
Yeah, just a couple things. First of all, I want to thank all of the veterans organizations, including our city employees, Tim Ross in specific, and others who made all of the Memorial Day services and events go off so well and be such a fitting recognition of our veterans who did not obviously gave their last full measure of their devotion. The other is that we have a soapbox derby track. City hopes to maintain it at Ben Hawes. There's a local competition out there this weekend, so for some reason you like soapbox derby, go out and watch it. It's a great facility. And the other is that the Owensboro Early baseball team is playing a game June 11th that I think we have a tie-in with. The city does, and so they play at 7:05 at Chautauqua if anybody's interested in that. So some activities to attend to in our community if you have the time and interest.
Very good. Commissioner?
I just want to extend my sympathy, and I know the commission as well, to the family and friends of Dr. Robert Dalzell, who worked for the hospital. He was an anesthesiologist and cared for many of the people in our community and region. And I remember the last time I saw him, I was at a hospital event at the convention center, standing over that beautiful balcony overlooking the beautiful Ohio River, and there were two planes just playing with each other, dipping in the Ohio River, and Dr. Bob Knight was there. And I said, who are those crazy pilots? And he said, well, one of them's Dalzell. So that was the last time that I saw him and his plane. And I know he loved flying and loved this community and did a lot for all of us.
Great. Mayor Pro Tem?
Oh.
I'll just move down the table.
Just a couple things. I had someone call me today about Legion Park, and they said it was packed with the all kinds of kids. Absolutely love the new spray park and all the they said there was lines of people. So I'd love to hear that how much use it's getting. The second thing I'd like to mention is Mr. Parrish mentioned we've added 245 new jobs from Sazerac and First Security. That's just to name two places, and there's so many more that I can name. And I really think that some of the investment that we've made is starting to bear fruit. And I think this is just the beginning, and you're going to see a lot more to come here pretty soon. The mayor and I were talking about someone else earlier, and since they weren't mentioned tonight, I won't mention them, but that there's a lot more to come. And that's very important because I'm huge on the private sector. And like Mr. Whitmer said, and jobs, that's 245 brand new jobs, and I think that's highly important, and I'm very pleased. Thank you.
Commissioner? First, before you say anything, I want to tell you that I thought you did a wonderful job at the memorial service on Memorial Day. That went very, very well. Your remarks, I think, were just absolutely right on. There is not another community that honors its veterans any more than this community does. And I know you are a big supporter of the veterans in this city, in this county, and I want to thank you. I want to thank you for that. But go ahead, Commissioner.
Well, thank you for the opportunity to be able to do that. I appreciate that. And I was going to say that Sheriff Kane mentioned that again yesterday at the honor flight. My husband went on the honor flight, so he was really excited about it. So they come back tomorrow, but Sheriff Kane mentioned the fact that. He agreed that there's not another community that loves their veterans like Owensboro does. And as far as Legion Park goes, I like the zip line.
See, okay.
There are pictures that show she likes the zip line, and so do I.
But that's all.
Okay, Commissioner, thank you so much. We'll now open it up to the public. Anyone in the public have anything to say? If not, I'll entertain a motion. We adjourn.
Motion.
Second.
Second. Vote.
Mayor Pro Tem Sanford?
Yes.
Commissioner Smithwright?
Yes.
Commissioner Glenn?
Yes.
Commissioner Nunley?
Yes.
Mayor Payne?
Yes. We are adjourned. Thank everybody for coming.